Margaret Morabito. In case you haven't heard of her, she had helped to write, or she wrote, I guess, for Bill Hurd. How do you describe that? The new book that he had, Back into the Storm.
Co-authored.
She also published another book, and she'll probably tell you more detail about the Commodore 128 called the Vintage Commodore 128 Personal Computer Handbook, 2019 Survival Edition. So years ago, she was a editor of Run Magazine. She also designed and ran the Tutoring Center and the Kulik Community College, as well as the Parent Teacher Information Exchange. She later ran the school on Genie, Delphi, CompuServe, Apple Link, AOL, and PC Link. But she'll go into detail with that more. So without further ado, Margaret Morabito.
Okay, thank you. It's good to be here. So I'm going to start off with a little bit more background about me. As you know, I was a technical editor at Run from 84 to 87. But before that, I was an English teacher at the Naval Academy Prep School. I also taught at Fitchburg State College. After that, I was the head of a computer learning lab at Fort Devens for the Army, and we were teaching basic programming and word processing on Apple IIs at that point. In 1982, I started up the Computer Assisted Learning Center as a very small offline learning center, and I was teaching word processing on a DEC Rainbow. The next year, 1983, I got a C64 on my own and started writing educational programs in BASIC on that. And it's pretty interesting. In 82, the DEC Rainbow cost probably up around $3,000. And by the next year, I bought my C64 for $199 at Child World. So it really was a huge difference. And that was kind of the beginning of my stepping into the Commodore realm. Later on, I became a service provider. This was as I got towards the end of my career at Run. I became a service provider on pretty much all the networks that were out there almost. Q-Link, PC Link, Apple Link, AOL, they were the quantum computer service networks. And I'll get into this later as I talk about this. The school, Calc, I brought online on Q-Link, and the school is still in operation online all these years later at calcampus.edu. And I'll get into that too. So my talk is going to be split into two parts. Part one is my work at Run Magazine and during those years, 84 to 87. And part two is going to focus on online education and what I did during the early years, the dial-up years, and also during the early internet years. So when I started at Run, this was in 1984, Run had begun in January of that year. I got there around May, I think. The magazine was growing very rapidly. They were covering the VIC-20 and the C64 at the time. By the end of that year, our December issue, which is the one on the right, had 224 pages, which at that time was huge. And it reflected the large number of Commodore users who were getting the magazine, and also the large number of products that were being made for the C64 and the VIC-20 at the time. And also, given the context that at that time there were several other popular Commodore magazines in publication. So it goes to show you the very large number of Commodore users who were out there, not just reading our magazine, but reading other magazines. This is a picture that I dug out of our editorial staff. When I began, Guy Wright was the technical manager. He's in the back row. I just have to say it, with the big hair, he's in the center. And I'm in the front row, second from left. So I was the technical editor. I started as assistant technical editor. When he became technical manager, the technical editor. As I said, the magazine was growing rapidly. You know, by 1985, the next year, we added a third technical editor, and that's Tim Walsh. He's over on the right. It was a good team. The magazine was published. We did 12 monthly issues, and then at the end of each year, we do a special issue. So, you know, it kind of kept us busy. We did a lot of the technical department. One of the things that we did was to select programs that would be published in the magazine. So we would test the program submissions that came in, and we had hundreds of submissions from people. And so we would test them out and decide which ones, you know, were worthy of going into the magazine. We'd make a pile of them. And then our editor-in-chief, Dennis Brisson, who I forgot to point out, let me point him out now. In the back on the left, that's Dennis Brisson, our editor-in-chief. He would make the final decision as to what programs would go into which issue. Now, if you're old enough, you might remember actually typing in programs like this. So our users would spend hours typing in the programs, and then they would run them, and they'd have their software. So we selected a variety of things. We'd get games, utilities, education programs. We wanted to have a nice variety. The C64 and the VIC-20 at the time were well known as game computers. But the C64 actually was also very valuable for applications and productivity. And so we were on the lookout for good quality application programs. One of the first applications that I remember selecting and testing out extensively was Mike Konchak's Datafile. And I worked closely with Mike. I spoke a lot with him on the phone so that I would be able to understand all the features of that program. And it turned out to be a very popular program. We published it in the November 84 issue. Another application that where I worked closely with the programmer was RunTerm Plus, which was our telecommunications program. Robert Sims wrote that program, and I worked closely too. He actually taught me how to go online. At the time, I think I had a 300 baud modem that I was using, and I used to call into his computer, and we would go back and forth, and he would teach me the various aspects of RunTerm. So, you know, I really appreciate the time that we spent together because he taught me a lot. I met both Mike Konchak and Robert Sims in person. Mike Konchak came to our offices in Peterborough, and so it was nice to see him. And I met Robert Sims at one of the CES shows. So typing in the programs, that was fun and educational for the readers. But for the longer programs, you know, that would be tedious. It would take a long time. So we ended up making what we called the rerun disks. And during my time there, part of my job was to compile the programs onto the disk, put on a menu program, and then also put together the documentation, which we had a booklet that went with the disks. And I would write the introduction to the manual. Guy Wright started doing those. And then as he got involved with other projects, I took over this. So what we would do would be put together programs from the last couple of issues, the more popular programs. And so we did that kind of like on a bi-monthly basis. And then periodically we would come out with what we called special rerun discs. So if you were a run reader back then, you might remember this. We came out with the game pack where we put on the games that were really popular. And then we also came out with the productivity pack. And that had programs like Datafile, Run Term Plus. We had a word processor called RunScript. So things like that went onto the productivity pack. People could buy these, and it turned out to be a very beneficial project that we did there. When I got there in 84, the Plus 4 had been just been announced in January. And that was the year Jack Tramiel left Commodore. When I got there, I had a Plus 4, and one of my first writing assignments was to review the built-in software. As you know, it had word processor, spreadsheet, file manager, graph maker. So I did these articles over a period of three different issues. And in my opinion, I actually thought it was pretty good. I know it got a lot of criticism in the US, but I really liked the concept of having the built-in software. And from what I had experienced up to that point for a 40 column screen, the software seemed pretty typical. But the users, they were looking for like the next level of software, and they didn't find that in the Plus 4. It kind of got panned, but you know, it was a good computer. It had BASIC 3.5 in it, which was much more advanced than the BASIC 2.0 in the C64. It's good. Anyway, on our schedule, our publishing schedule, we had to have articles done 3 months in advance. So for example, the December 84 issue, which was the first article that came out that I did about this on the word processor, I had to have that done in September. So by September, I had the December issue done for that. By the time we got to December, we were already working on, what would it be, March issue. We're coming up to the articles and programs that would have to be in the March issue. And by that time, the C128 had already been announced. So things were moving very quickly, and we had to kind of move with the technological changes, given the fact that we had a 3 month lag time that we were trying to keep up with. So 1985, that was a very big year for the Commodore. There's a lot of changes that were occurring then. As I said, in January, the C128 arrived. Run discontinued coverage of the VIC-20 and brought on the C128. So now we were going to be covering the C64 and the C128. Also that year, the Amiga was unveiled. And also that year, QuantumLink opened. So these were all huge changes that came upon the scene that year. When the C128 came out, Commodore came out with this ad where they identified the top two competitors for the C128. Which were the Apple IIc and the PC Junior. So taking this ad as kind of like a starting point, I was assigned to write a comparative analysis among these three computers. And so I prepared and wrote this analysis for the June 85 issue. And clearly the C128 won.
Yeah.
You know, there may be some Apple fans who differ, or PC Junior fans who differ. But in my opinion, that's how that went.
I have to agree now, with that.
Now, the Plus 4 had been criticized highly because it was not compatible with the C64. And so as you've probably heard Bill Hurd talk about many times, he was bound and determined to make the C128 C64 compatible, which it was. What many people didn't know when the C128 came out was that you could also use the C64 peripherals with it. Now, Commodore had announced the new 1902 monitor that was going to come out, the 1571 disk drive. But during 1985, the 1902 monitor didn't come in. It wasn't produced. You couldn't buy it. So I started fiddling with the C128, and I found out that you could use it with a 1702 if you had a 1702 Commodore monitor, and you could use it in both 40 and 80 columns. But I just had an old monochrome monitor. I had a Zenith green monitor at home. So what I did was, my husband and I actually, because he knew what he was doing on this, we built a cable that would go from the column port on the C128 into my Zenith monitor. And it gave me a nice 80 column display. And I could also get a 40 column display on that monitor. So then coming back to the office, I was able to test it on the 1702, and we could get both modes on the 1702 also. So anyway, I put together this article, which talked about the backwards compatibility, so that people who had already bought maybe a C64 and had a 1702, or maybe they just had an old monochrome monitor like I did, they'd be able to use the C128 and get going. It was interesting to me when I was working with Bill Hurd on his book, we got to a point where he was talking about the fact that he had made sure that the C128 would be able to display 80 column monochrome output. And it was at that time that I realized that he had done a really big favor to the Commodore users, because someone like me, and there were probably many other people too, we were able to get the 128 and start right off the bat with the 80 column mode. So we could use the CPM in 80 column mode. We could use the 128 mode in 80 columns. So it was very useful, and I appreciated that. It was kind of interesting to talk to him about that. At the time, and this is still in early 85 now, Commodore sent us a C128, which came to me, and I was at the point where I was mulling over doing a book, and I decided, yeah, I want to do this, because I was really interested in this computer. And the C128 that I got at that time, and this is another thing that I found out after working with Bill Hurd on his book, was that what I had was a Rev 6, which was a pre-production model. And Bill said it was probably one of the ones that was at that January CES. And I found this out because when I was taking a photo for his book, I took apart my C128 and I was looking for the RIP message that was imprinted on the bottom where the three layout guys had worked for that whole weekend during the weekend of tears to try to catch up on the production schedule. Anyway, after I took apart the whole thing flipped over the motherboard, there was no RIP message. And I'm there, you know, what's with this? I don't have it. And he explained that this was a Rev 6, which didn't have that. The RIP message came out with the Rev 7s in January when they were trying to catch up. And the Rev 7s were the ones that went for production. So it was kind of interesting, and I still have that one, and it works. So it's remarkable, because it's not like I was taking pristine care of this. I actually have three of these now, which I've had for many, many years, and they just pretty much were kicking around, but I didn't beat on them, but I wasn't actually trying to take that great of care of them. So they were well made. As I said, I was writing a book on the C128, which I did finish in 1985, and I had a contract with a publisher. As it turned out, that didn't pan out, and the book was not published that year, but I kept it. And in the book, I talk about this story. Many years later, in 2016, I dug out my C128 and started working with it again, getting familiar with it again after many years of not using it. And my son encouraged me to dig out the book and finish it up, which I did. So I brought it out and updated it so that I talked about the modern day peripherals that were now able to be used with the C128. And at the time, actually, I was really surprised, pleasantly surprised, that there were so many hardware makers, you know, like the ST2 IEC, which would work with this, and the wireless modem, the Ethernet modem. I mean, things that I hadn't even thought that would work with the C128, but they did. So I talked about them in the book. And that was published in 2019. When I was getting ready, when I had finished the book and the updating, I contacted Bill Hurd, who I didn't know at the time, and asked him if he would write the foreword, because he's the designer of the C128. Seemed like it would be a perfect match. And so he did, and I was very thankful for that. Later that year, Bill contacted me and said that he was thinking of doing his own book and would I like to work with him on it. And I said, yeah, let's do that. So his book is called Back Into the Storm, and you can see that on the right in this screen. You know, he's the designer of the Plus 4, the C128. It was just the perfect match for us to be working together, because I had been working at Ron and writing about the computers that he was actually designing and building down at Commodore. So it was a lot of fun. Also, see, we're still in 1985. So at the time that I'm working with the C128 and trying to get familiar with it, putting together the book, you know, really getting to know that computer, which has three operating systems and just has a lot going on with it, the Amiga, meanwhile, was coming on the scene. And I didn't know what would be happening really with the Amiga, but in March, Guy Wright and I were sent out to California to Commodore Amiga. And we visited this new computer and we talked with the engineers. They showed us what it could do and talked about it. Also early that year, I went down to Commodore headquarters in Westchester, Pennsylvania. And so I was getting familiar with the Amiga. We didn't have an Amiga to work on actually up at Run, but so I was learning about it from the engineers and from specs that they were giving to me. So I was preparing to write this article for Run magazine, which came out in the September 85 issue, called Meet the Amiga. And what I didn't know early on when I had gone out, Guy Wright and I went out to California to meet with the engineers there. What I didn't know, and I found out soon, was that our publishing company, CW Communications, was going to be coming out with a new magazine. And that was going to be called Amiga World. And the reason that they did that, a new magazine, is because the Amiga was so different. It was something that we just would be within the confines of Run. So they came out with their own magazine. And you know about the Amiga, but it was advanced. It was a 1632-bit processor. It had the custom graphics and animation chips, custom sound chip, graphical user interface. It was really a totally new generation of computing. So Amiga World came on the scene. The premier issue came out in September and October of 85. And at Run, we were scrambling because we were helping to get the magazine off the ground. Guy Wright became the editor-in-chief of Amiga World. I moved up to be technical manager at Run, and then Tim was working with me at Run still as the technical editor. So for that first Amiga World issue, all of us in our editorial staff, we contributed in some way to this magazine. I wrote the lead article, the first look at the Amiga. And again, I didn't have an Amiga in hand for that. So I was working from what I had seen and also from, specs and documentation that had been sent to me. They asked me in the next issue, which was there on, what would that be? November, December, I think, because it was bi-monthly at the time, to do a comparative analysis. And again, the Amiga just, it was very advanced. So to compare it to the IBM PC, there was really no comparison. And comparing it with the Mac, there were similarities, but the Amiga offered much more. And the Amiga was going to be sold to a different, totally different audience. So Ron continued to cover the C64 and the C128, and that's where I kept my focus. So I didn't really do much at all with the Amiga after that, although I did end up with an Amiga 500. And I'm not sure how I ended up with that, but the C128 was really my computer. In 1986, Commodore came out with the C64C, which really was just redesigning the case of the C64 to make it look really nice and streamlined like the C128. And they also came up with out with an updated 1541 disk drive. During that year, they came out with the 1581 disk drive, which was a nice 3.5-inch floppy drive for the C128. That next year, in 87, Commodore started coming out with their line of PC compatibles. We didn't really cover the PCs, but I did do an article, announcing them. Ron's focus continued on the C128 and the C64. The C64 in particular never went. It's kind of interesting that even with all the technological advancements of the Amiga and what was going on also with the Mac and, with the PC compatibles, everything was just moving forward, that the 8-bit machines, still had a good following. And Ron actually kept publishing up until 1992. I left in 87. As I said, it used to be a monthly publication. Then it turned into a bi-monthly, and finally it ended in 92. So I'm going to backtrack a little bit now, trying to give you like a full picture of what was happening at that time at Ron, and probably similarly at other magazines that were covering the Commodores. Part of my job was to go to trade shows and Commodore events. In 1984, the first show that I went to was the World of Commodore, and that was up in outside of Toronto, Canada. It was a huge show. It had 41,000 attendees, and I only know that from Wikipedia, so maybe it's not exact, but it was big. I got a nice shirt and hat from that show, which I really enjoyed. You can see on my desk there, I've got a +4 and a C64. I bought both of those at Child World for $199. And there's my green screen monochrome monitor. In the CES shows, before I get into the CES shows, the users groups were very important to the success of the computer, and we would cover the user groups and what they were doing in the magazine. TPUG helped out with the World of Commodore shows, and that's the Toronto PET user group. And they were, after Commodore went out of business, and I found this out later, that in 2004, after Commodore was gone, TPUG actually started holding World of Commodore shows again, and have been doing since 2004. At that time, and this was in 1984, I was sent down to Florida to the, what was it? I think it was the West Palm Beach user group. No, it wasn't. It was Daytona Beach area Commodore user group. And what they were doing at that meeting that they invited me down to was that fiscal information systems, they had made a hard disk drive for the C64. I'm pretty sure this was the first hard disk drive that was made for the C64. And they were demonstrating it at that user group meeting. So I went down there and attended the meeting, saw the demonstration of their hard disk drive. This is just an example of how user groups were really very involved with what was happening in the Commodore world. So moving on, I attended a couple of CES shows. That's the Consumer Electronics Show. And one that I remember is the Chicago show. and at that show, Steve Case from Quantum, he was hosting a private viewing of this Habitat, which Lucasfilms had designed. And it's essentially, if you know about it, it was a virtual online world where you would create your own character and pick your clothing and pick your home turf, your furniture, your pets, and you could interact with others in this kind of cartoon world. And at the time, it was, really revolutionary. And so I went over there and saw that demonstration, talked with the Lucasfilms people, and wrote an article for Ron about it. The Habitat, which is what I just showed you, that was going to be put onto QuantumLink. We just call it Q-Link, but QuantumLink, which was the Commodore network that came out back in the 80s. Actually, it was announced in 1985 and came out that year. What I'm going to do now is transition, and I'm at a point now where I'm still working at RUN, but I'm starting to transition to my career where I'm combining education with telecommunications. At RUN, I wrote a monthly column called The Resource Center, and that talked about how people were using their Commodore computers for teaching. And so what I would do is teachers who were using C64s, primarily C64s, would write to me and tell me how they were using their computers in their schools. Parents would write to me and say how they were using the computers at home for teaching their kids. And I even found a library that was using a C64. So through the Resource Center, I was able to tell people out there, you know, how they could use the Commodore computers for teaching and learning also. Combined with that, during this time, I had been writing a series of articles about telecommunications and what was happening. There was a lot of activity back in the 80s about that. You would probably remember CompuServe. I wrote articles about the Dow Jones News Retrieval, CompuServe, The Source, Delphi, PlayNet, PeopleLink, Telelearning, Viewtron, and other services that were online. But the one that was most interesting to me and to our readers, of course, was QuantumLink. So it premiered in November of 85, and this was their startup screen. It was nice. It was different because it was so colorful. It was very familiar. I don't, if any of you were going online back then, you might remember PlayNet. It was actually very, very similar to PlayNet, which was a games network. It was designed specifically for the C64, and of course, C128 users in 64 mode could use it. Commodore was selling their 300 baud and 1200 baud modems, so you could log on with the modem. At that time, you had to dial into your local telenet or TimeNet packet switch network with a modem. And then once you got connected, then you could go on to, you know, be transferred over to the Quantum Link network. If you lived close to one of these packet switch networks, it was a free phone call. But if you were in a rural area like I was, you'd end up paying a long distance phone charge just to get to the TimeNet connection point. So, I remember once I started working for Quantum Link, I would have monthly phone bills like around $400 or $500 a month, which it's like, that was a lot, but it worked out because the services ended up bringing in money that would help cover things. Early in 85, this was in July, I had been sent down to the Mid-Atlantic Regional Commodore Association Convention called MARCA. And that was where they were showing us a prototype of Quantum Link. So that was pretty good. You know, it's nice to be in a situation where I was able to see things that were being developed before they actually came out to the public. That was actually quite nice, now that I look back on it. My interest, of course, was the Learning Center. When I first visited Quantum Link, you know, online, they had essentially they had an online encyclopedia, and they had a catalog of courses that the telelearning company was offering. So I started mulling this over, and I had my little computer assisted learning center, and I was thinking, you know, I could do something like this online. So I sent a proposal to Quantum Link, proposing doing the tutoring center, and they accepted it. And so I started building the tutoring center. This was something that was very new. And it was actually, you know, as with many of the speakers that I've noticed during this show, there were a lot of firsts. And I believe from my research that I did back then, that the Tutoring Center was the first nationally available online tutoring center. And eventually we added on the QLink Community College. But what we did was I scheduled hour-long sessions each night in the areas of math, science, computer science, general studies. We had message boards, had live sessions, we had download libraries, we had online quizzes. So we had a lot, we had all the tools on Quantum Link that we needed really in order to run an online school. I started the tutoring center in 86, and what I did in 87 was I took a couple of videos of what was happening, and I never thought that I would be using those videos all these years later to illustrate what we were doing. But so what I did here, I took some screenshots from the videos because I have about an hour's worth of videos, and I'm hoping to be able to make those available later online. I'm not sure how, but I'll figure it out. So in this picture, what you can see is the menu that we had for the tutoring center. So we had, all right, we had an information center, but the actual school itself is where you look at the English, math, science and health, computer science, and general studies. Those were the academic departments. Within each of those departments, you would have message boards and download libraries. And then we also had an area for the classrooms. And we had, I think, five different classrooms, you know, A, B, C, D, and I would assign the teachers to their particular classrooms at a certain time. We also had an online quiz section. The teachers would write online quizzes for their subject areas later on for their courses, which their students could take online. And we also opened those up to the public. So if people wanted to come in and just take quizzes, they could come into the tutoring center and do that. this is an excerpt from a chemistry class that we ran. We started the Keeling Community College in the summer of 87. This was actually by popular demand. In the tutoring center, we started off and people really loved it. They came in, we had people coming in, I had things scheduled 7 days a week, Monday through Friday in the evening hours, which was the least expensive time. It was something like $3.60 an hour, something like that, for weekday nights. And then on the weekends, I would schedule, I think we started at 11 o'clock in the morning, early in the morning until 11 o'clock at night. But we had a demand right off the bat in the tutoring center for more structured courses. So I took what we did in the tutoring center and I built the Keeling Community College. And this is a Q-Tutor BH. We called the teachers Q-Tutors, and then their initials came after. So this was Bernie Hiles, our chemistry teacher. And he's holding a class here. You can see up at the top where it shows the list of the students who are in the class. And at the time, I was logged in so that I could videotape this. And I'm Marg M on this. We also held a spelling bee, and we had other academic games that we would hold. But the spelling bee really caught on. Q-Tutor LK, that was Karen McAllister. She used to run these. And it's kind of fun. She'd type in a word, and it would be misspelled. And then the participants would type in the correct spelling, and she would give them a certain amount of time to do it. So she would type go and people would type in what they thought was correct. And then she would type stop. And then she would let the participants know who got it right. It was kind of fun. Quantum Link came out every month with what they called the Q-Link update. And these were, you know, short magazines, booklets, where they would talk about, you know, what they were offering, what was, you know, what were the various groups that were there, schedules, so that people knew when to log on to go to whatever they wanted to go to. So I have a bunch of these, so I figured out that I would show you these. It just so happens the one on the left here, these three people are Commodore employees. Q-Link was a kind of like a cooperative venture between Commodore and Quantum Computer Services. And Fred Bowen is there on the right. He was one of the guys who I talked to when I visited Commodore when I went down to visit the Amiga. This is an example of the tutoring center schedule that we had in the Q-Link updates. So here you can just see the various subjects that we were offering for tutoring, drop-in sessions, starting at 6:30, we had basic math, then at 8 o'clock, physics and chemistry, 9:30 algebra, that was in room, classroom B, classroom C, we were tutoring German, 11 p.m. in classroom A, history. So we had a lot of different subject areas going on. And I tried to accommodate the timing so that West Coast people could get in on this at the same time. The community college also had its schedule published in the Q-Link update. Our first semester, we actually offered 12 different courses. Pretty good. You know, we had world literature, creative writing, which was a very popular course, Algebra 1, Calculus, Earth Science. I'm not going to list all of them, but machine language programming was very popular. So when I was going back over my paperwork that I saved from back then, which I have like a ton of it that I had to go through to try to remember what I was doing then. The computer programming courses, they got a lot of participants, and the creative writing had a lot of participants. So that was interesting. We also offered introductory Japanese at that time. When students would complete a course, I would issue them a certificate of course completion. I'll be talking pretty soon about the networks that we were on, and the certificate would identify which network. So if you took the course on QLink, it was the QuantumLink Community College, issued by the Computer Assisted Learning Center, CALC. And if you were on PC Link, it would come from the online college. And then eventually when we left the Commodore networks, the Quantum networks, I should say, I issued it from the Computer Assisted Learning Center under its name. Another service that I offered in the Learning Center was the Parent Teacher Information Exchange, PTICS. And that was a place where parents and teachers and students could get together and they could talk to each other, share ideas, ask questions. We had message boards in there. We had download libraries. In this particular article that I wrote for the QLink update, I was talking about our special needs section that we had just opened up. So we had a lot of different things going on. It was fun. In 1988, I started, this was after I left Ron. The concept of the research resource center was very popular, and I still had people writing letters to me and telling me what they were doing with their computers, with their Commodores. So this year in 88, I started putting together a monthly newsletter for parents and teachers. And I would there were several articles that I'd publish in each issue and put in a software review. Different people would contribute articles and reviews for the issue. So we kept things going so that we could continue to share this information after the Resource Center column ended. And people were also sending me educational discs with programs that they had written, shareware programs, self-written programs. And I had a dual disk drive. I'd make copies of these discs and fill them up with programs and mail them out to people. So I actually have, I think it's like 6 or 7 discs still now that I've put them into D64s so that if anyone was ever interested, you could contact me and get those. So in 1988, Quantum started expanding and they came out with PC Link. So I opened up my services on PC Link. And they also had the monthly booklets. They called it the PC Link update. Then Quantum got together with Apple and they arranged for the Apple Link Personal Edition network. In 1987, I was hired by Apple for a short-term one-day project. I was a consultant, so I went out to California, and they wanted to find out from me what I had done with QLink, with the Tutoring Center and the QLink Community College, because they were in the process of developing what they called the Apple University. I don't know what happened with the Apple Link University, but over on the Apple Link network that Quantum opened up, I was running the essentially the QLink Community College, but we called it the University of Tomorrow. And this all happened like between 88 and 90, where Quantum was opening up these other kind of specific networks. So for PC Link, you needed to have a PC compatible. I used my PC 10 to do my work there. And on Apple Link, you had to have an Apple II, Apple IIe. So that's how that was working. And then finally, towards it, it kind of all happened at the same time, but it was kind of unclear what was happening. But at the end, it turned out that Quantum opened up America Online. So, and they stopped PC Link, I'm pretty sure. Actually, I left in 1990, so I didn't really pay that much attention to what happened after that. This is a blurry picture, but this is an example of multitasking in 1988. And I thought it was interesting because if you, that's me, and in front of me, there are two keyboards. There's my PC-10 keyboard, and it's sitting on top of my C128. And way over on the right, there's an Apple IIe. So over at my desk, I would work on PC-Link with the PC-10. And then when I was finished with that, I would just set that that keyboard aside, and then I would boot up my C128 and go on to Q-Link. And then when I needed to go on to Apple Link, I'd go over to the other computer, the Apple IIe. So it's kind of fun. So in 1989, I started thinking about consolidating onto a different network. Things were kind of challenging, you know, to work with one computer with that network, another computer with that network, and another computer with that network. So I was looking for something that would be more centralized, something that the students could use without needing to have a specific computer or specific software to access. And so I went over to Genie, the General Electric network. So I brought the Calc Tutoring Center and the Course Center over to Genie. Genie was nice because it had an international reach. It was not computer specific. And what I found out also that was a nice feature was that if you wrote an email and you accidentally sent it to the wrong person, you could get it back and delete it before it was delivered. That was kind of a neat thing. Very helpful at times. Genie also had their monthly booklet called the Genie Livewire. I operated on Genie from 89 to 96. It was a good platform for us. Let's see if I have this. I want to go back here and point this out. Despite the fact that Genie didn't have the nice color and graphics that the Q-Link network had, it was good for the reasons that I mentioned prior. On this menu, I don't know if you can see it or not, but down at the bottom, number 15, it says for students, homework help and tutoring. And you go over to the right and there's Calc. So you would type in the number of the area that you wanted to work in, you wanted to visit. And so that's how that worked. Moving on, when we got to 1995, the internet became available to the public. And so what I did was I opened up my own in-house bulletin board system for CalCampus. And what I selected was Galacticomm's World Group. And these are a couple of pictures, main menu over on the left. You know, you would come in and you could go to the teleconference, info center, message board, file libraries, check your account. This interface was pretty advanced and it allowed in the classroom over on the right, this picture, they had a drawing board. So if you wanted to, if a teacher needed to use a blackboard, they could use that. And there was also a chat window at the bottom. This was a system that I had modems. I had a modem connected so you could modem, you know, you could dial in if you needed to. But most people came in through the internet. We had three ways of access. We had web lines set up, which was, you know, any web browser, you could get into there. You could create an account, come in, download the syllabus, download the course materials, interact that way. We had a rudimentary chat set up in there also, so someone with a web browser could use the system. There was also a plugin for Windows or Mac, graphic user interface, which allowed you to utilize what I showed you on the prior page here. And you could also Telnet in plain text mode. And we essentially had all the same tools that we had been using over on the other networks in prior years. In 2007, CalCampus became regionally accredited, and anticipating a larger student base, I moved over to a hosted system, and we use Moodle, and we use Moodle today. So from that 2008 to the present, we've been using this system. CalCampus is found at calcampus.edu, and it all began with the QLink Tutoring Center. I know I'm getting towards, I'm running out of time here. What have we learned? 36 years ago, Commodore users were online. Many people today don't even know that there was anything online before the internet, and that would have been in 95. 36 years ago, Commodore users were doing online distance education, and most of the country didn't even know about it. Much has not changed since 1986. Many of the tools that we used back then are the same. The main difference from my viewpoint is the video chat classroom. And of course, everything else goes much faster today than it used to. Parting comments. I worked at RUN at an extraordinary time where I was able to experience technological advancements as they occurred. I had a supportive editor-in-chief at RUN, Dennis Brisson, who allowed me the opportunity to explore education, computers and education through the Resource Center, and also through the telecommunication series that I did. I was able to participate in the early development of online education in the 1980s for the masses. And that was thanks to the Commodore 64. The teachers who I worked with over all these years, they were the pioneers, and they were the ones who made this succeed. And lastly, my staff all through these years has been have been family members, and they've supported me and my work throughout. If you're interested to find out more information about early online education, you can go to calcampus.edu/research.htm. And that's all I have. Do you have questions?
All right. Thank you, Margaret. Do you have any questions from the audience? Yes. Do you have any future plans for any books?
Actually, yes, I do. I've been working on a CPM book dealing with the C-128. Which I started a couple of years ago and got sidelined. So I have that kind of in the background. When I prepared this presentation, it actually gave me some ideas for possibly putting this together or parts of my online education work into a book. We'll see how that goes.
Any other questions? For your future CPM book, are you in contact with Von Ertwein?
Not yet, but I saw him yesterday at the Gaggle Fest, and he's someone who I definitely would like to speak with.
Any other questions? Yes. Are you willing to put your materials on the Internet Archive?
What materials do you mean?
What? So the newsletters and other pamphlets and things like that that you were showing.
Oh, yeah. Sure, I could do that. I'm not familiar with that. But, you know, if you tell me how to do it, I can scan the stuff and put it up. I would be happy to share that information.
Yeah, I can tell you how to do that. We can keep in touch. Anything else from the live audience? All right, so let me go to YouTube. There's a question here. Did you ever work with Jim Butterfield?
No, I didn't. No.
All right. What did you think about his expert knowledge on the C-64?
Oh, Jim Butterfield?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. He was a great contributor. Actually, the first time that I heard of him or knew about him was in the first edition that where we covered the Plus Four. And he had written, actually in the issue before, he had written a lead article talking about the Plus Four. So that was where I first heard about him. And yeah, he was a great, he made great contributions. And he did some articles for Ron also.
Someone says, do you think you are the Jim Butterfield of the Commodore 128?
I doubt it, but that's a nice compliment, even just to have that question.
Bill Hurd says, get Von Ertwein to write the foreword for the CPM book.
Okay, I'll remember that. That's a good one.
So my question for me is, what you did, the online learning and teaching, were you more or less managing, or did you actually teach the individual courses? What was your role in the learning centers?
Well, I was the director, but I hired I had teachers. I forgot to mention this. When we started the tutoring center, we had 25 different teachers. These were people who were already teaching in offline schools, and they had Commodores and they wanted to teach online. And I gave them the opportunity to do that. And even today, you know, I also have taught many courses. I don't teach today because I'm more involved with the administration, but I was the director, but I also taught, but I was just one of many teachers who were teaching in the school.
All right, and Bill Hurd says, great to hear your story, Margaret. And everyone.
Thanks, Bill.
All right, any more questions from the live audience? All right, well, that sounds like it. Everyone, big round of applause for Margaret Morabito. Thank you very much for this talk. I was very glad to have you here. You sort of inspired me to create the theme for this show. You know, when I saw that you had co-wrote the book with Bill Hurd, I'm like, well, who is this woman and what did she do? And I'm like, oh, wow, this is very interesting. I need to invite her to VCF East. And that started like my thought, all right, women in computing. And yeah. Got a lot of great speakers. So I was very glad to have you here.
Yeah, thank you. I've enjoyed it. And you really put together a good show. I've been watching it online.
Thank you. All right. Thank you. Have a good weekend.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.